we will still be captives. Men who are in prison, they get out, and they still feel like they're captives. Because they're captive by things that Paul is speaking about in these texts in Colossians. Today's text is a magnificent one. The title of the sermon is Calling to Death and Life. It's one of the things where you sit and think, what should I call this? You could call it a lot of things. Doesn't mean it's only about the calling of death and life, but it just seemed to occur to me as I was thinking about this, is that we're called to death, but that death gives us life. And this text of Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 through 4 certainly highlights that. Could you stand with me as we honor God's word again? Please read out loud if you wish, first four verses of Colossians chapter 3. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. Father, I praise you for the power of your word, because you have placed your breath in it, your inspiration, something we hear. It doesn't have to be something we prove. It's something we each are touched by. It's not someone gives us permission to believe, or permission to be touched, because you seek us and you find us in the circumstances of our life where we are, and you call us to your hiding place, that place where we come and we die. We die to our ambitions, we die to our failures, we die to our angers, our hatreds. We die to our past, and we come to a new place in your presence. This place of safety and security and promise, freedom, distance around space to be who we are. It is expanded because Jesus Christ is who we're linked to. The source of life, the source of authority, source of freedom. I pray today, Father, to awaken us to these truths by your inspired word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. We note in this text,
I'm trying to do something else at the same time.
The first word, since.
I'm trying to record this.
Since. In some translations, you'll see if. I don't think anyone uses the word therefore. But clearly, Paul is making a transition here. And very much like the letter to the Ephesians, which, because it's an epistle from its beginning, epistle being a treatise, something that's written to be circulated, like a guidebook, a manual, in the book of books. Ephesians was that very thing. I think that we often make the possible mistake of asking people who are new converts to read through the Gospel of John, although that's certainly a gorgeous and wonderful book. The book of Ephesians is the book that tells us how everything works theologically, what the theological side of things is, and then how it's practically used. Call a course to have in our seminary, Principles and Practice of Christian Community, is the book of Ephesians. And it's very likely a book that Paul, or an epistle that Paul, sat down after writing books such as Colossians, and Philemon, or Philippians, where he was writing these truths to people. They're having problems, and so he's giving them the theological perspective. It raises their view of God and this world around them. It interprets it, gives it meaning, puts things in their proper place, and then from that strength, he then talks about the practical things. And we see, it doesn't take very long to just look forward. If you have a Bible that has, you know, headings and things like that, you'll see their practical relationships he's going to talk about here in this next chapter. And in chapter 4, that are how all this works out in human relationships. And as a result, what we find is that we're not people who work toward theological perfection. We don't work toward the idea that something's going to happen if we work for it. Come to realize that something has happened for us. Something's already taken place. Something's already been struggled through. Something's always already been paid for. Redemption. Like Deborah read this morning. I love those two things. We are redeemed by his blood, and we're forgiven for the sins that come from that fallen nature we have. Amen. Two things must be the case. God can't say, well, something he could say, but God doesn't say in his word, I just forgive all your sins. No, that makes us have a sense of there may be missed one someplace. No, he says, I redeem you. I buy all of you. I purchase you by the blood of Christ. Your past, your present, your future are purchased by the blood of Christ. We're redeemed. And then those sins that come out of that unredeemed, that sinful nature that we inherited from our father Adam, and Eve, our mother, forgives them. He remembers them no more. He doesn't hold to our account. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Are you convinced of that in your heart and mind? Since then, I would argue that Paul, the Hebrew scholar, very familiar with poetic literature, Hebrew poetic literature, in the same style of Hebrew prophetic literature, we see the presence of parallelisms all the time in Hebrew literature. All the time. Parallelism. It's making a statement, repeating, making a statement, repeating, statement, repeating. Earth's the Lord, the fullness thereof, the worlds that they dwell therein. He founded on the seas, he established on the floods. Does that sound like a repetition? You see the repetition. And what we do is we take our Western perspective, everything means something, and we, you know, look at it as word by word by word by word, don't see the real picture that's being presented. And here he says two things. He says, since then. In case you didn't recognize it, Paul wants to emphasize this. Call it twice. Since then, you've been raised with Christ. You can do something. You can set your hearts on things above. There's no barrier to setting your hearts on things above because you have been raised with Christ. What does he mean when he says that? He earlier said in chapter 2, verse 12, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. Jesus' work at the cross has been accomplished by Jesus. It's accomplished so that he can satisfy the justice of God on our behalf. But the first movement is the sacrifice to satisfy a just God. And he's accomplished that. And as a result, it's a complete work. Sin has no ability to degrade that work or hold it down or make it somehow inconsequential by some action. He has redeemed all of our sins, all of our failures, all of the things that we are accused of. by both principalities and powers and philosophies that he's talked about. We have been raised with Christ, for when he rose, with our sins and the power of our sins and the payment of our sins, when he rose, we're connected to him. We rise. Baptism is more than just getting wet. It's more than saying, oh, I'm a Christian now. When we see a person who is baptized, we see them making the statement that I have an identity with Jesus Christ in his death. Why? Because my sin was the reason he died. That's my identity. I have sinned, therefore I have an identity with Christ. And when Christ died, my sin died.
Amen.
I don't know how I can comprehend that. Why? Because I keep sinning. He's redeemed all the sins I have committed, all the sins I will commit. I'm trusting I'm not sinning right now, although maybe I am, so I need to be careful. Right now, you know. We say past, present, future. And usually the... Never mind. It's like Augustine says, I can talk about time as long as I don't have to define it. We find ourselves in that category of what is the present? Well, the present is some place where something is finished. It's a place today where Jesus Christ dwells with a finished work. And we are with him. We're with Christ in his death. Why? We have to be. Because it's in our sins he's dying for. Therefore, we're with him. This idea of baptism. Baptism, which you were also raised with him. Not only have we died with Christ, but when he rose. And why can he rise with sin? Because he has swallowed up the power of sin in his righteousness. He swallowed up. He's absorbed it. The power of our sins. Sin of our nature. As a result of that act, we rise with him. Since this is true, he said, since it's true that you have overcome, that Christ has overcome the principalities and powers of this earth. Verse 17 of chapter 2, should you have your Bibles open, these are a shadow of things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. The law, new moons, festivals, the Jewish influence was something that is fulfilled in Christ. The pagan influences are something that have been overcome and defeated by Christ. He's so meticulously gone through those categories. The reality is found in Christ. Here he says, since this is true, since Christ is raised from the dead, since Christ has died for sins, you've been linked to him. You have been raised. Don't underestimate with Christ. You don't become a Christian without Christ. Jesus made this statement, you must be born again. I can remember so vividly, very dear friend of ours. In fact, it was Woody Woodward, who's just died this last week, 97 years old. He sat in this church for 30 years. And when I would talk to Woody, he would say, I never heard this! He sat in a different church for 30 years before that. 30 years! Christian church! You must be born again, Jesus said. Ever heard that? Didn't ever know if that was even in the Bible. Didn't ever hear that. You must be born again. You must identify with Christ. You must die with him so that you can rise with him. And he just simply says, since this is true, then, since it's true, well, it better be true. You know, it's a little thing, but it better be true. If you say I'm a Christian, but I don't really get into that born-again stuff, I'm a Christian, but the blood kind of bothers me. I'm a Christian, but the rising from the dead, that's kind of troublesome to me. God, awaken that heart. Regenerate that heart. Since you have been raised, the idea of raised is not just, you know, some idea. It's not like some construct, some abstract. We literally have been awakened from death. Ephesians chapter 2 tells us that. That we were dead in transgressions and sins, and while we were dead, he awakened us. He made us alive. Is that your testimony? I've been made alive. Something's touched me. Something's awakened me. Something's identified me with Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
It's the Holy Spirit. Should be every one of our testimonies. It should be, as we listen to worship, we think of Jesus dying on the cross. For who? Me. It should awaken that moment. In times of long, dark struggle with not having it makes it so intense when we do have it. Why is that person I've been praying for all these years, why aren't they getting saved? I've shared the gospel with them. I prayed for them. Why aren't they getting saved? It just seemed to be in darkness and denial and everything. Well, when they are saved, they're going to know the difference between what they were and what they are. That was certainly my case. I was raised in a pretty Christian context. To think that you are awakened and you see that the context you were in is not a context of salvation for yourself personally. It just thrills your soul. Paul's not talking about, well, follow these methods and you'll be okay. The new law, you know, you've been raised with Christ. So therefore, start thinking about Christ. You've got to start thinking about Christ. You've got to start thinking about things that are above. That's just impossible to keep the law. I used to pray that prayer as a boy. I remember all the way through my childhood, I'd say, Father in heaven, forgive me for my sins, and let me think about Jesus tomorrow. I said that over and over and over and over. Now, if I was thinking about Jesus tomorrow, I probably would have said, thanks for letting me think about Jesus all day. But instead, I would say, Father, forgive me my sins, and tomorrow let me think about Jesus. For the next night, with sincerity. Father, forgive me for my sins and help me think about Jesus tomorrow. Because I certainly didn't think about him today much. That's a great prayer, isn't it? Until you're awake, all you think about is Jesus. All you see is a world that looks like a Jesus world. Think of the Apostle Paul, the righteous Apostle Paul, spending his life destroying the church in one instant, in three words, I am Jesus, he says to Paul. And he's awakened and everything is reoriented. Suddenly he's preaching from the Old Testament that he knows so well. He's preaching Christ, it tells us. He goes, you didn't have to go and say, well, wait a minute. Martin says, wait a minute, you need to learn all this first, Paul. You need to learn the Old Testament. You need to learn how Jesus. He said, man, I have just been reoriented. Who said, with a southern accent, we need a paradigm shift. Our paradigm does shift in on us. Now, Jesus is the center of everything. Paul didn't need somebody to connect him. He started connecting all the dots instantly. Since you are raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above. This isn't a statement of you must do this or try to do this. It's an avenue that's right there available to you. Would Paul just simply say to an unconverted person, you need to set your heart on Christ? Why would he first of all say, since then you've been raised with Christ, how do we set our hearts on Jesus? All you do is just let what's set happen. Is that how you pray? I pray because I pray at 8:30 in the morning, and I pray for these dozen things, and afterwards I thank the Lord for prayer, and I wait till the next day. Is that how the Lord prompts us to pray? You walk, you drive by. Yesterday we were coming from National Airport, and there's this beautiful family, and they're sitting on the side of the road, and they're looking at the overlook. They're looking at the overlook. You know, the overlook, which just drops down the Twinbrook, you can see all big pentameter thing. They're all looking, and down the end is this about a three-year-old girl. She's about this far from the edge, and she's just standing there looking as we went by at 50 miles an hour. I can see Christy, I can see Katie, I can see David, I can see Daniel, I can see Lucy, I can see every dozen other kids. Stick. I said, Lord, protect that child right now. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. I'll get this on my list so normally they don't pray for this. The Spirit prompts us, doesn't he?
Yes. Amen.
He nudges us, he urges us. Prayer is not some, you know, it's certainly a discipline. But it's really an obedience to do what we can do. We can come before the Father, can't we? It's not that we must come before the Father. We can come before the Father. You have been raised with Christ. Therefore, set your hearts on where Christ is. Instead of looking at that circumstance and that circumstance, oh, I'm oppressed, oh, I'm having difficulty, I can't overcome, poor me, poor me, poor me, poor me, oh, how terrible everybody else is doing this to me. And instead of that, oh, let's look at all these principalities and powers and, you know, all these things we see around us, the philosophies of the world, oh, we can't, that, you know, we're just surrounded by all kinds of evil. The world's going crazy, it's just going into the hole. Hey, set your affections on Christ. Jesus isn't up there sweating.
Amen.
Oh, God. I tried to save him, but I don't know. I just need to give up. Things have to be good. Plead with God. Help me. Help me. Help me. Oh, we just learned from Paul that he has done a finished work. He has made a spectacle of the perversions of philosophy. He has made a spectacle by nailing them to the cross. And we, in our sins, were nailed there. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Again, in the 20th verse of chapter 1, or chapter 2. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules which you have to do with these rules, which have to do with things that are destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Human commands and teachings. I always think that the, you know, no, I'll say that for a second. I'll use that in a minute. Well, he says this then, doesn't he? Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Since you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things of the earth, for you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. You are dead, you are dead. Where'd that come from? Sounds like a song, doesn't it? That's where it came from. What's the second verse? Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. What's that verse 2? Verse 1 was, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. I'm just keeping this melody. The second was, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. You've been raised with Christ. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ God. You see how he's saying the same thing twice? He wants to emphasize it. Doesn't mean it doesn't have content. It's not just repetition. It's the repetition of the content. And the way you repeat the content is you say it once, and you say it a little bit differently the second time to expand it. That's when a parallelism is truly a parallelism. Set your hearts on things above. And here he says, set your mind on things above. Specifically referring to this long expression when he's talked about with the influence of pagan philosophy and then Jewish religion. So you set your hearts on things, and you set your mind on things. Things that are above, not earthly things. Looking beyond the oppressive context of this earth. If you think Jesus came to first change the oppressive context of this world, you have missed Christianity by an eternity. Jesus said, I have not come. I've come to save you out of the world. Your message and your ministry is in the world. You find yourself in a tough place. You find yourself in an oppressive spot. You find yourself, someone's coming against you. You're exactly where you should be. Oh, hear this before Christ. Oh, I just wish we could work at the church where everything's just perfect because all the Christians are there. I'll just answer the phone for Chris for one day. Oh, we've been to the church so many times. What's your name? No name anywhere. We know the pastor. What's he look like? Oh, he's a really good guy. He gets a big description of it. Oh, we know. And before long, you get the big one. We're having trouble. We need some money. Can you help us? Well, sure. We have some referral things. We refer to you. I won't tell you the rest of this conversation. It's kind of X-rated, you know what I mean? Uh-huh. And she gets cussed out. I want money. I don't want advice. I don't want help that way. I want money. You know, the world system has this illusion that Christianity is this place where nothing's going on. Is that really the history of Christianity? I love Charles Haddon Spurgeon when he said, how have we received the gospel? We receive the gospel through prison bars. We receive the gospel from the bloody hands of martyrs. That's how we receive the gospel. What should we expect? Our problem is not so much that, you know, we can't get rid of all the problems in the world. Our problem is that we don't recognize that Christ has conquered the problems of the world, and we are in a hidden place with Him already, where it's already resolved. Now, does that mean it's otherworldly? No. It means that I can praise Him in my troubles. We start praising God, and it's great. All my trials will soon be over. All my trials will soon be over. On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land, for my possessions lie. This world is not my home, no. I'm just passing through. If heaven's not my home, then, Lord, what will I do? And one of the amazing things that came out of that awful time of slavery in the United States was they listened to their master's message of Christianity, and it touched their hearts and awakened them, and they could put up with the inconsistency of the slavery by worshiping the one that gave them real hope. And not just, I'm hopeful for the future. No, I am in Christ. We don't have a hope for the future in Christ. We're in Christ. We're raised with Christ. Christ is the sacrifice. He's brought us to a reality. He says you've died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. We talk about the relationship of Christ. What is the incarnation? What is the nature of Jesus the Christ? In the beginning was the Word. The second member of the Trinity, the Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit, an eternal relationship with each other. One in substance, power, and eternity. The three are the one God. Second member, the Word, became flesh, shared flesh with this virgin-born man. Born without a sin nature, because the sin of Adam did not touch him through his father, Joseph. He was born and born of the Holy Spirit. And as a result, he was God-man. He was man being prepared to be a sacrifice, a fit sacrifice for the sins of many. Amen. Are you one of those many? I'm certainly convinced that I am. Why? Because I'm just such a great guy. No. Because he's awakened me.
Amen.
And he's demonstrated to me that I've been raised with Christ. You know, worship is setting our affections on things above.
Yes.
Great is thy faithfulness. Oh God, my Father. You've almost helped me in everything I struggle with. That's how we sing it. That's how we live it. We walk around complaining about how terrible our life is, how terrible the world is, if we expect it's not supposed to be that way. Jesus said, I'm not praying for the world. I'm praying for those you're going to call out of the world. I'm praying that they will be faithful. The word that they receive, I'll pass it to others. What's the word pass on to others? Oh, we make it through because Jesus helps us. Oh, we make it through. No, we've already made it through.
Amen.
We're hidden with Christ in God. We're connected in the same way that Jesus is connected with the Word of God eternally. The Word of God is connected to the triune, divine person of God. As a result, we're connected to Jesus Christ. He's connected to the Word. The Word is in God. We're connected eternally to Him. We're sons and daughters of God.
Amen.
When He awakens us, He awakens us and He says, I'm awakening you so that you can make a decision whether or not you want to be a son of God or not. What gospel is that? It's all to you. He awakens us and shows us what we already are. Will you believe that Jesus died on the cross for you? Will you believe that? Do you believe that? Since or maybe. Imagine what this would read like. Maybe, then, you have been raised with Christ. As a result, orient your free choice to things that are above, not on things of the crop of the earth, where Christ is seated right in God. Start doing that. Do it. Do it. Do it. Is that what happens to you? I come and I start worshiping God. I think, man, I gotta ask God to forgive me my sins and ask Him to let me think about Jesus tomorrow. Or I just become overwhelmed by His amazing grace.
Amen.
What Christ has done, not only for me, but what Christ has done for all those the Father has given me. Jesus said, all the Father has given me, they're coming to me. Aren't you glad you don't talk to 12 people? He's that kind of worldview. And his worldview was not just the world he's living in, the population at that time. It's his people across the whole dimension of time and space. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with him in glory. In Thessalonians, Paul said, you're very troubled about people that are dying. Let me enlighten you. Those people are already in Christ. They're not going into a place of death. When they die, they go into a place of not hidden relationship. I mean, this world is kind of a hidden relationship with God, right? Even in our minds, we're kind of always wondering, is this, you know, we have this dim, dark mirror in front of us. Paul says, You see through a glass darkly, remember? 1 Corinthians 13. But then, you're going to see face to face. And no eye has seen, or ear heard, or mind conceived what God has prepared for those who love. Jesus said, don't let your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If this weren't so, then why would I go and make them? I'll make them for you. He didn't ask us to believe. He said, why would I make all these rooms if you weren't coming here? Nothing can separate the love of God, nor the height, nor depth, nor principalities, nor anything. All creation, Paul says in Romans chapter 8, will separate us from the love of God. But now it's kind of hidden, isn't it? It's a reality, it's true. God sees it in His side. He tells us in His word it's true. But it's hidden, but there'll be a day when it's going to become manifest. Whether it's time that you pass to be with the Lord, it's going to become manifest. You're no longer feeling like I'm trying to hold on, or he's trying to hold on to me, or it's a question of whether I'm really this or really that. But that hidden sense he talks about here. And then he says, your light is hidden. Who? Christ and God. It's an unbreakable relationship between us and the divine person of God. That it would be manifest. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with him in glory. And we still feel this fear of judgment, you know, the final judgment. It's true, we're all going to pass the judgment. Every one of us. Will my name be in the Lamb's Book of Life? As if God's up there, he hasn't written any names down yet. Got a book in front of you, hasn't written any names. Okay, number 3,546, you can call. Now, tell me your reason why you should come to heaven. Lots of great jokes about that, aren't there? Everybody has already spelled me, M-E. Okay, your word is chrysanthemum. Spell it. When you get to heaven, it's a good joke. No one's laughing because I guess I didn't tell everybody. Has blood on it. There's no power in it. Because Christ has paid the penalty. Christ has paid for the sins of our lives. And there'll be a day when it will be. You think we like to clap a little bit after we sing a song. You know, I kind of clap after we sing a song, right? It's beautiful, isn't it? Just kind of clap. By the way, you should put it there. Clap now. No, clap. No, it's just, we just kind of clap, right?
Yeah.
Someone really moves you, we stop singing. Mine is, let's don't clap yet. Let's sing all four verses again. That's not right. Take your liberty. Christ will show us the indelibleness of his relationship to us. He'll show us the places where we felt we were alone, we were never alone. The place we felt unloved and we were never unloved. The place we felt oppressed and we were free. When Christ appears, it will be manifest what a relationship to him is. How could he say it any more succinctly? How could he emphasize it any more clearly? What a transition statement. That because it is true, put to death, therefore. Notice the verse 5. Put to death, therefore. He's going to give us a litany of things you can do. You can do these things. Why? Because Christ has died. Because you've died. Because Christ has risen, and you're risen. Because you're changed. You can do these things. You can stand in the face of evil, and you can proclaim Christ is Lord. I love John Huss. All I want to do is just tell his story. And he had to answer two questions for his counsel. And the counsel's two questions were, are these all your writings, Mr. Huss?
Yes.
Do you recant all these writings, Mr. Huss? Just two questions. Martin Luther, same two questions. Tyndale, same two questions. Over and over again, same two. Are these your writings? Yes. Do you recant all of them? No. Can't do it. Martin Luther says, good conscience. These are God's words. How can I recant God's words? That kind of tribunal is not what we're going to face. We're going to face a tribunal where Christ is exalted again and again and again and again. If we die, it is a benefit.
Paul
said, live as Christ.
To die as gain. And here in these passionate words, as we go to the next section, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Father, I pray you awaken us to the reality that's around us. You awaken us, Lord, and comfort us, and assure us of the true reality we live in today. We live in a reality of death and a reality of life. Let us set our affections on Christ and the things above. Waken us to these. Give us dreams, Father. I pray dreams will happen in this place. We'll see. Not this, these simple things we want to get, we get things we want. I pray, Father, you give us dreams that point us to Christ. Devotions, scriptures as we read, worship choruses, hymns, great hymns of the church that awaken us and point us to your victory. We're so content to grab the failure and complain about us, to rise up and see Christ has made a path for us to give glory to him. Hosanna! Hosanna! Save now! These persons or powers that were so advanced, they can't ever change. Hosanna! Jesus said, you don't cry Hosanna, these rocks are going to start crying Hosanna. He's not finished saving those high things that exalt themselves against him. And we haven't finished declaring Hosanna. Help us in our weakness, Lord. Waken us. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you.
That's glory is between glory and God.